Tonight on Thames Sport, we spotlight the three major issues that have rocked the sporting world this week. Hello, good evening. Yes, it's been a pretty bleak week for world sport for a variety of reasons, and tonight we take a hard look at the three big stories that have dominated the headlines over the past 7 days. In cricket, after the underarm bowling fiasco in Australia, we talked to one of the game's most notorious characters from the old days, now shocked at the way the game is going. In boxing, we ask just who is Harold Smith, the man who brought the sport to a shuddering halt this week. And in racing, we talked to banned jump jockey Barry Brogan, who this week alleged race-fixing and corruption on the turf. We'll also announce the results of our Thames Sport Sunday soccer poll, highlight Queen's Park Rangers' promotion push in the second division, and preview the National Cyclocross Championships taking place this weekend. But let us begin with cricket and Greg Chappell's decision to ask his brother Trevor to bowl underarm in the one-day international between Australia and New Zealand in Melbourne. The decision came with New Zealand needing 6 to tie with one delivery remaining, and it caused such a stir that even the prime ministers of the two countries have condemned it. In a moment, Fred Truman, one of the game's greatest characters, who himself was seldom far from controversy in the old days, has his say. But first, Simon Reid looks at exactly what happened.
Yes, here are the Chappell brothers plotting the dirty deed, a tactic that's caused more consternation in cricket than anything since England's bodyline bowling in the early 30s. It's obvious that even some of Chappell's teammates, Rodney Marsh here included, aren't too impressed with the idea. Now, Trevor Chappell normally bowls medium pace, but he'd been taken for 57 runs in just 10 overs, and Big Brother obviously decided he couldn't be risked. So this is what we get. McKechnie can't be bothered with it, he's disgusted, and so is much of the cricket world. So I asked Fred Truman what he would have done had Greg Chappell asked him to bowl that very last ball underarm.
Let's put it this way, Simon, that if I'd have been a senior player, I would have refused completely. In fact, I might have taken it as an insult to do such a thing. After all, I think he was a number 8 batsman that was in. On the other hand, if it had been a junior player like Trevor Chappell, his brother is, and is fighting to try to get a place on the England tour later this year, it would have been a very sticky position, and I might have had to do as I was told. But first might I say that it's deplorable that this should ever happen. But secondly, one must look at it and put things in his perspective, and that is, that did he break any rule? I don't know of any rule that says you can't bowl an underarm on the last ball if, say, 4 or 6 are required to win or tie, and in this case it was a tie. OK, it's not a very good thing. It's not a very good advert for the game of cricket. In fact, it's a slight on the game. But the man hasn't broken a rule. The rules are there to be played with.
So you wouldn't discipline Greg Chappell then?
No, of course I wouldn't discipline Greg Chappell. How can you discipline somebody that hasn't broken a law? The authorities now must get together at the next cricket conference and say, this will not be allowed again. We have learned a lesson. It's a piece of history in cricket now that Trevor Chappell, on the instructions of his brother Greg Chappell, the captain, bowled an underarm in a one-day international match. So, it's now history. So the cricket conference have got to pass a rule now to make sure that it will never happen again.
F.S. Truman talking a lot of sense, it seems to me, and incidentally, Fred is 50 not out today, so many happy returns to him. But now, from controversy in cricket to chaos in boxing and the extraordinary saga of promoter Harold Smith. After all the dreadful publicity boxing received last year, the death of Johnny Owen, the demise of Muhammad Ali, and the sudden capitulation of Roberto Duran against Sugar Ray Leonard, the last thing the sport wanted was to be taken for a ride by a cowboy promoter. Hal Smith was a rock concert organizer before turning to boxing just over a year ago. He immediately began to lose vast sums of money, paying way over the odds for fights which, like this one, between Matthew Saad Muhammad and Lottie Mwali for the WBC light heavyweight title in San Diego, took place in front of rows of empty seats. Nevertheless, Smith always came bouncing back, and his bill at Madison Square Garden, New York, scheduled for 23rd February and including four world title bouts, was hailed as the fight night of all time. He was also the middleman for John L. Gardner's projected fight with Muhammad Ali and Jim Watt's next world title defense. But this week, everything came crashing down when Smith suddenly went missing, and so did at least $21 million from the Wells Fargo Bank in Los Angeles, which has now issued writs against him to get their money back. Smith has now reappeared, but whatever he has to say for himself, three major boxing dates are in ruins. Reg Gutteridge is ITV boxing commentator. He joins me now. Reg, you've actually met this man. What impression did you get?
Well, two or three times. He was all a bit unreal. He was really walking around with a suitcase full of money. Very introverted, could hardly get words out of him. Baseball cap, beard, used to be a rock concert man, as he sort of stayed in that, really. I think he was trying to buy some sort of fame in the macho boxing business. And I've seen that many times, and Hal Smith was one of these people. But everybody in the fight game was a bit suspicious of him because he was paying these terrible inflationary prices. And the fight that you referred to in San Diego, the very next night he ran another one in Los Angeles, and the total losses were $5 million. Nobody's had that glory before but Harold Smith. And I don't know, somebody was out pointing a computer, one of his friends by the sound of it, but there are no criminal writs against him yet. But I wish him luck trying to get the money back from the people that he's already given it to.
What are the consequences going to be now for people like Jim Watt and John L. Gardner we've mentioned, and indeed Muhammad Ali himself?
Well, it is bad news because, I mean, he was putting up so much money for Jim Watt and Agüero and Gardner and possibly Ali, and they do have, in fact, deposit money. And if he's got to prove, and they've got to say, well, you're not getting it back because we did it in all good faith, you wanted our services, and we're going to hang on to it. And I think they may well do that. So it'll be a winner for them. He hasn't hurt anybody actually in the game. He's only hurt the image, and very badly, obviously. You know, and other promoters will be pleased to see him off the scene. But the one good thing that it's done, and I spoke to Muhammad Ali's wife today, is he's the only one that was ever going to pay those inflationary prices for that match between Gardner, or mismatch between Gardner and Ali. And now that's out, and I think that Ali is finished. And that's one good thing that's come out of this.
The most bizarre affair, Reg Gutteridge. Thank you. Well, it's also been a week in which racing has suffered a great deal of adverse publicity. It's centered around the confessions and allegations of former top jockey Barry Brogan in his book published this week. John McCurrick of The Sporting Life takes up the story.
In the late 60s and early 70s, Barry Brogan rode 416 winners. On occasions, he partnered those greatest of horses, Arkle and Red Rum, but was best known for his association with the Dickler, a huge chaser who went on to win the Cheltenham Gold Cup. Perhaps Brogan's greatest victory was here on the Spaniard in the 1970s Scottish Grand National at Ayr. But his book isn't so much about the glory days as the seamy side of racing. He claims 50% of jockeys bet, races are fixed, and he boasts of his addictions to drink and gambling. He's now a member of Gamblers and Alcoholics Anonymous and was released from prison only last month after 15 months for theft. The Barry Brogan story is not pleasant, involving as it does betrayals of trust and friendship and confessions of lying and cheating. So isn't he ashamed of his association with this book?
I'm not actually, no. I've nothing more to hide. Basically, I was the person that was at fault. I admit I was wrong. I don't condone a lot of the things I did in racing.
Let's get on to specifics now. You gambled, you lost £600,000. But jockeys aren't allowed to bet. How were you able to get the money on?
Well, obviously, there was other people had these large sums of money on periodically, mostly SP.
And you say 50% of jockeys now bet. Is that correct?
I would say that that would be correct, yes.
How often, Barry, did trainers instruct you to lose races?
I was very fortunate that I never rode for very many non-gambling stables. So during my lifetime, I was never instructed to stop very many horses.
But you were instructed to stop some. You say in your book you had up to £25,000 on other horses in the same race that you were riding on. Are you expecting us to believe that of all your 2,770 mounts, you never pulled one? Every one of those ran on its merits?
I wouldn't say every one of them ran on its merits, John, no.
So you did pull horses?
I did, yeah.
Are you prepared to name the horses you pulled?
No.
Why not?
Well, I don't think it's very relevant at this particular stage, is it?
But you expose other things. Why wouldn't you expose the horses that you pulled?
Well, I mean, I can't remember any just off the top of my head at the moment.
How much race-fixing is there by jockeys going on at the moment?
Well, I think it's very prevalent in the racing world. I haven't been involved myself in racing for about 3 years, but the Jockey Club did issue a statement inside the last 12 months, the RSS, which is the detective agency of the Jockey Club, whereby they were more concerned about information exchange between jockeys and people in racing and outside racing than they were about dope.
But you allege in your book also that the stewards are corrupt. Is that correct?
Well, this does happen, yes.
You say they bet, and then they judge on objections, and they've actually had bets in the race.
That is true.
Does that still go on?
I shouldn't think it's changed since I've been out of racing.
Because that is the most serious charge you make in your book, isn't it?
Well, I suppose it's one of them, yes.
As for punters, you say, and I quote in your book, the trusting little punter is being ripped off with greater and greater impunity. What can be done about that?
Well, I think I've just mentioned about the Jockey Club. I mean, they're aware of what's going on. I think they're doing a wonderful job in trying to clear up this mess. And I think in recent times, they deal more stringently with cases of horses of non-triers.
And finally, Barry, talking of bookmakers, you say, they are born vultures, forever circling around, greedily awaiting to swoop on easy pickings. Doesn't that pretty accurately sum up your career in racing?
Unfortunately, latterly, throughout my career, because of my compulsive gambling, my greed for money, my immaturity, insecurity, quite unstable in many ways, it is, yes. But that is the Barry Brogan that's in the book, but not the Barry Brogan you're talking to today.
Barry Brogan, admitting there for the first time that he deliberately prevented horses from winning. I wonder why that didn't come out in his book.
John, thank you. And still to come tonight, why Queen's Park Rangers are suddenly challenging for promotion from the second division. Your verdict on Sunday soccer, and our look ahead to the National Cyclocross Championships with London's brightest hope. John is after the break. Back, and it's with soccer we resume, and in particular the sudden promotion charge of Queen's Park Rangers in the second division. When Terry Venables and Alan Harris took over at Rangers in November, relegation seemed more likely, but now the picture has changed dramatically, and this was their latest success at home to Cardiff on Tuesday.
Rangers took their time before moving ahead. This is the nearest they came in the first half, just a minute from the interval. Andy King hits the post there as Cardiff failed to clear that Tony Curry corner. 5 minutes into the second half, Rangers do take the lead. Tommy Langley's done the hard work, and the ball finding its way for Terry Fenwick to bundle the ball over the line. And just after the hour, Rangers make it 2-0. Cardiff again make a mess of a clearance. Tony Curry is on the ball now. Then it's Barry Siltman who puts the ball back in. Simon Stainrod heads it on and sets up Tommy Langley for his third goal in 3 games since he was put on the transfer list. Rangers' improved form has failed to inspire their supporters. Less than 10,000 were there to see the Cardiff game. And just before the end, the faithful saw the most exciting moment. Siltman's enterprising run ends with this crashing shot coming up. Rangers can't force the melee home, but they've now taken 10 points out of the last 12 and are just 3 points behind third-place Chelsea. So things obviously going well for Queen's Park Rangers. And tonight's big soccer news is that Terry McDermott, last season's Player of the Year, has been dropped by Liverpool for their match at West Brom. He's replaced by Jimmy Case as manager Bob Paisley makes 4 changes from the side beaten at home by Leicester. Here in London now, there's a possible return for David O'Leary, Arsenal skipper. O'Leary's been out of action for nearly 3 months with hamstring and Achilles injuries and has a late test before tomorrow's match at Stoke. The Spurs striker Garth Crooks is expected to recover from a knee injury in time to face Leeds at White Hart Lane. Mark Falco will play his first game of the season if Crooks fails to make it. Ian Walsh, the Welsh international, transfer listed by Crystal Palace, is recalled at Ipswich. Jerry Murphy is also back, as Palace are without suspended Jim Cannon and Tony Seeley. Motor racing now, and a great start to the Grand Prix season for little-known British driver Nigel Mansell. Mansell, a 27-year-old from Birmingham, finished eighth in today's final practice for tomorrow's South African Grand Prix in Kyalami. Brazilian Nelson Piquet was the fastest ahead of Carlos Reutemann, but Mansell was the highest-placed Briton. John Watson was only 15th. And there's a couple of good racing stories as well. Here's John.
And first news from Sandown, where one of the Grand National favourites, Spartan Missile, ridden by 54-year-old grandfather John Thorne, won the 3 o'clock, only to be disqualified for hanging left on the run-in, and the race was awarded to Ramblix. That Spartan Missile on the left of your screen jumping the last. But it was a splendid reappearance by the Missile, and John will definitely ride him at Aintree. And now terrible news for anti-post punters. Bright Highway, favourite for the Gold Cup at Cheltenham next month, will not run. Last month he injured a foot at his Irish stables. This morning he hurt a hind leg at exercise and that clinched it. So Bright Highway is out of the Gold Cup. Two leading Gold Cup fancies, Night Nurse and Diamond Edge, clash at Sandown tomorrow. But the tip, it's up to Weatherby in the 1 o'clock Castletown Lad. He's got some good form in Ireland. And although his main rival Hairshawlin attempts his fifth win on the trot, an each-way wager on Castletown Lad offers the day's best value.
John and Simon with today's main headlines. Thank you. Well, time now for the results of our poll on Sunday soccer, an issue to be discussed by representatives of all 92 league clubs on Monday. The majority of London clubs we found are in favour of the move. Of the 12 managers in the capital, only four are against the idea. Terry Neill of Arsenal, Mike Bailey of Charlton, Keith Birkinshaw of Tottenham and John Lyle of West Ham. But it seems that you, the fans, aren't quite so convinced. 56% of you cast votes in favour, 44% against. As for your views on the subject, Mr. S.A. McMillan of Chingford spoke for many of the lobby in favour of a Sunday morning start.
The crowds will be in a more relaxed frame of mind, therefore more tolerant. If hooliganism is associated with alcohol, supporters could neither drink nor buy drink entering the ground.
Mr. McMillan foresaw one other big advantage.
I suggest that Sunday soccer will mean larger gates, and perhaps this could mean a reduction in the cost of entrance fees. The price of football is now so high that it can no longer be a priority for available money.
Arguing against Sunday soccer, 14-year-old Susan Grutt from Barking contended,
Sunday railway and bus services are not sufficient for transporting thousands of football supporters. In this respect, Sunday football would reduce gates rather than increase them.
And she echoed the sentiments of many people on one basic issue, religion.
I'm a strong football supporter, but also regard myself as a very strong Christian, and at the moment can cope with these two commitments admirably. However, Sunday football would oppose my religious beliefs, and I'd be forced to choose between going to football and to church. My decision would be to reject Sunday football.
Well, Miss Grutt and Mr. McMillan will be receiving £25 in premium bonds for those views, but thanks to all of you who wrote in. And don't forget, the 92 league clubs meet on Monday to decide whether Sunday soccer should go ahead. Now, I'd like to draw your attention to a programme on ITV this Monday evening that provides a remarkable insight into the running of a football club. Called City, it highlights the fortunes of Manchester City in the past few months with Malcolm Allison and John Bond, the most prominent characters. Here's a glimpse of what's to come.
Put it in a nutshell, I've seen Tony and Malcolm about an hour and a half ago. We talked about the club's position and I put it to them, asked them to, if they'd like to, I don't think like's the word, but if they'd resign from the position of manager and coach. And that's what they've done.
Well, artistically,
John Bond's been off the day. Position as manager of Manchester City, which he's accepted. The only problem with, slight problem we've got, which I'll be dealing with after we finish here, is the question of compensation with his club.
This is the story of two men who were teammates in the 50s. On the left, Malcolm Allison, the teacher. On the right, John Bond, his pupil. 30 years later, their paths cross again.
So there you have it, City, the inside story of Manchester City, Monday night, 10:30 on ITV. A word of warning, though, for parents considering letting young children stay up and watch, I should point out that a lot of the language in the programme is straight from the dressing room. Incidentally, I understand Malcolm Allison will not stay with the Lions League club Yeovil when his spell as consultant ends in 3 weeks' time. He said today, I don't want to be manager and I intend to leave in 3 weeks, no longer. Now, finally tonight, a look at one of the country's newest sports. Cyclocross established itself in Britain only 10 years ago, and now we have 10 riders competing professionally. This weekend sees the national championships, so we thought this an opportune moment to look at one of London's most promising young riders and also trace the development of the sport. Your reporter is Phil Liggett.
In Europe, cyclocross can attract crowds of 40,000 to its top events. And in Sutton Coldfield on Sunday, around 10,000 are expected at Britain's own Open Championship. It is no longer a winter pastime for the summer racing cyclist, but a very serious sport for the riders who prepare only for the winter months. And the more bad weather, the better they like it. London's top rider and main hope on Sunday is Steve Walter, who has been competing since he was a schoolboy.
Well, Steve, you're 27 today. Do you spend all your birthdays like this?
Well, Phil, just the last couple of years I seem to have been. Yeah.
What exactly do you class yourself as? Are you a cyclist or are you an athlete?
Well, it's a bit of an all-rounder, yes. Really. Mostly a cyclist.
But you're a professional, aren't you?
That's correct, yeah.
Does that mean you earn all your living from riding a bike over mud?
Wish I could say I did, Phil, but unfortunately it's still in its infancy, the sport, really, although we have quite a good following now.
Does it cost you personally a lot of money?
Not now I've turned professional. I actually do make something out of it.
You actually show a profit at the end of the season?
Yes, oh yes.
And it's that popular. How many riders do you get in an event on Sunday, for example?
Well, this national championship, this year, for the first time, they've actually had to limit the field. Yeah. In the past, it's been open to all comers, and we've had fields approaching 150. Well, I think at one point it got to 180. This year it's been limited to 80 because the riders of lesser ability sometimes block the...
Star men, so to speak,
exactly,
like yourself.
Yes.
How do you see your own chance on Sunday? There's one particular good rider in England, isn't there? Chris Reggitt.
Yes, Chris is very good.
And
indeed.
He's an amateur, so that's a bit of a chagrin, really, isn't it?
It certainly is, Phil. Unfortunately, there doesn't seem to be much we can do about him. He's been unbeaten in Britain now for two seasons, and he's certainly a very strong man, and I think it'll be a good man that beats him.
Yeah.
A very good man.
How do you feel, Steve, when you're at the top of a steep drop and you look down the mountain and there is mud at the bottom? What goes through your mind before you actually tip off the edge?
Get it over with.
Do you fall off often?
It's a strange thing. You generally only fall off when you're tired or if you're under pressure. If you have a rider about 30 seconds behind you and he's closing the latter stages of a race, you try and push yourself a little bit more and you make silly mistakes.
And that's when you come tumbling down the hill head first.
You're better if you can keep your concentration going and not worry about the other people apart from the people up in front of you. Yeah?
What about the possibility of cancellation on Sunday, because the snow is coming down from Scotland, we hear. Is there a likelihood that there could be no national championship on Sunday?
No, we ride whatever the weather. The only thing, in fact, that's ever stopped a cyclocross is foot and mouth disease a few years ago.
And our best wishes to Steve and our other young hopefuls this weekend. Talking of young hopefuls, news just in from Innsbruck in Austria, of course, where 18-year-old British skater Debbie Cotterill lead the European Figure Skating Championships after the compulsory figures and short programme. That's good news indeed. Good luck to her. As for next week, we have an extra date with you on Tuesday night, where Midweek Sports Special features exclusive highlights of one of the night's League Cup semi-final second leg ties. And Thames Sport will be back next Friday at 6:30. Until then, good night.